Namaste everyone, welcome back to another session of Science at Your Tips. This is Madhuri, science teacher working in BBDAV school. So here we have discussed about some of the physical properties of metals. Let us continue with the remaining, and also along with that chemical properties also we will discuss in this session. So let us start the session. Here we have our next physical property, that is electrical conductivity. Here you know already that many of the metals are used for conducting the electricity. You might have seen many of the metallic wires which are there in our electrical wires, because metals are having the property of ductility. They can be used as wires and they have this property of electrical conductivity. That is why we are using them as electrical wires. So this is the property by which they are able to conduct the electricity, and because of this only they are used in many of the electrical fittings, that is electrical wires. And you know already that non-metals, they don't have any property of this electrical conductivity, but here also we have one exceptional case, that is allotrop of carbon graphite, which can conduct the electricity. We are going to see some of them, like graphite rods. We are going to use it for conducting the electricity. In electrolysis process we will be using that. You can see that in our other lessons, like electric current and its chemical effects, and also even in metallurgy also we will be using these graphite rods. Coming to the next property, this is sonority. This you know already, that is sound producing property. Mostly metals will have this sonority property, because of that only they are used for making the bells in temples and also in schools and in many places. So these all metals are having the property of metals, they are having the property of sonority, but non-metals, they don't have the property of sonority. Means we can say they are non-sonorous, means they can't produce the sound. Okay, now let us start some of the chemical properties also. Here if you observe these chemical properties, you know already that metals are having the property of electropositivity. They can lose the electrons. Non-metals having the property of reduction, that is they can gain the electrons. They are electronegative in nature. You will learn these properties in your next classes. Higher classes you will learn what are these electropositive and electronegative. Now you just remember that metals can lose the electrons, non-metals can gain the electrons. Based on this only many of the chemical properties are there for metals and non-metals. So let us see the properties of these metals and non-metals, chemical properties of these metals and non-metals. So the first one will start here, that is reaction with oxygen. Many of the different types of metals we have. Some are very highly reactive, some are moderate reactive, and some are very less reactive. So based on their reactivity, they will react with the oxygen. So metals will react with the oxygen to form metal oxides. And these are metal oxides, they are basic in nature. Why we are calling them as basic in nature? Because whenever they are dissolved in the water, they will form bases. That activities also we'll see here. So here we start with the highly reactive metals like potassium, sodium, calcium. These all are highly reactive elements. So they can react with the oxygen which is present even in the atmosphere also. They are very highly reactive. So if you observe the equations, sodium reacting with oxygen to form sodium oxide, potassium reacting with oxygen to form potassium oxide, and calcium reacting with oxygen to form calcium oxide,
And if you see magnesium, magnesium does not react with the oxygen at room temperature, but when heated it burns in the presence of oxygen very vigorously. Very high amount of light energy and heat energy will be produced, and we are going to get this magnesium oxide in the form of ash. So here you can see the equation for that. 2Mg plus O2 gives rise to 2MgO. Based on these equations, children, you can remember the reactivity order also. You can write potassium at the starting, next sodium, next calcium, next magnesium. Like that we can continue. Okay, we will see this reactivity of metals also again. One more topic also, one more session also we have based on the reactivity of metals. Now, coming to this, aluminium. Aluminium, it will develop an oxide layer. Whenever you are exposing that to the air, it will develop some oxide layer. So this oxide layer, whatever is formed, it is going to protect the inner metal. Inside metal, whatever is there, that will be protected because of this coating of aluminium oxide after. So the inner metal will be protected from further oxidation, and it will prevent that to undergo the corrosion. So here you can see the equation for the aluminium reacting with the oxygen to form aluminium oxide. And zinc. Zinc, if you take, it will burn in the air only when you are heating that very strongly. So from potassium onwards up to zinc, if you observe, what is happening? Potassium, sodium, calcium are able to react with even with the atmospheric oxygen. If you go for potassium and sodium, they are very, very highly reactive. That's why every time we are storing them in the kerosene. Calcium can do that. Next, magnesium, little amount of heat, it wants ignition. And aluminium, again we have to, means it is also taking place in the presence of some heat. Better than zinc. Next, zinc. Zinc, whenever it is very strongly heated, then only it is forming zinc oxide. Otherwise, it will not. And if you observe about iron, iron will not burn in the air, but iron fillings, whenever they are sprinkled on the flame, they will burn vigorously. If you take small iron pieces, iron fillings, if you are sprinkling them on the flame, they will burn very vigorously. We are going to get iron oxide. Iron react with the oxygen to form iron oxide. Means iron will undergo corrosion in the presence of water and oxygen. That is another case. There we are getting hydrated iron oxide. But here we are discussing only reaction with oxygen, but not reaction with the water. So here you can see iron reacting with the oxygen to form iron oxide. Okay. So this is the about reaction with the oxygen. Even if you observe the somewhat moderate reactive metal we have here, copper. Copper is a very least reactive metal compared to the remaining. So it will not burn in air, but whenever you are heating this copper, it can react with that atmospheric oxygen only in the only when we are heating that. Then only it is going to form a black color copper oxide. So this is an endothermic reaction, we can say. Copper will react with the atmospheric oxygen only in the presence of heat. Okay, so this is about some of the metals examples which are reacting with the oxygen. And if you observe some of the low reactive metals we have, these are low reactive metals are unable to react with the oxygen. Like we have gold, platinum, silver, these all are unable to react with the oxygen. That's why we are able to get them in their native form. In the starting of the lesson, introduction part, we have seen already, these all metals are known as less reactive metals. They are found in the earth crust in their native form. Okay. So we'll continue with the remaining chemical properties in our next session. Even reaction with oxygen for non-metals also we have to discuss. We'll continue in our next session. Thank you for watching. Thank you, everyone.